This is Josiah Plays Lone Wolf Flight from the Dark. So I'm trying something new here. Don't know how it'll go, whether or not I'll like it, whether or not anybody will watch it. It's a little strange. I got this idea from a streamer named Arvin Elleron. He's a much bigger streamer than me. He's an awesome streamer. He does all kinds of cool stuff on his stream. He does interviews with game developers. He does giveaways. He plays different games. He plays D&D on his stream. And the last thing he does is he reads in a participatory style with his chat. He reads through these old game books. If you're not old like me, you might not know that back in the 80s, there was a time when video games were kind of just getting started. They weren't as popular or mainstream or ubiquitous as they are now. And so there was, for a time, there was a great popularity of a thing called a game book, which was these sort of novels, sort of like choose your own adventure novels, if you know what those are. Except they actually had stats and like a role-playing system to them. And you would read through these books and you would make choices and they would direct you to different parts of the story. And there was, you know, rules to it. So you would play it. You would play the book. It was a single-player reading gameplay experience. And there were tons of these books written. There were lots of different series of them. The Fighting Fantasy series was the biggest one. And those are the ones that Arvin Elleron reads and plays through on his stream. But there was another series called the Lone Wolf series, which were my personal favorites. I mean, these are like the heart and soul of my childhood right here. Like, I loved these books so much when I was a kid. And I must have read them all a bunch of times and played them, and they were so great. And so I was thinking, you know, if Arvin Elleron can do game books on his stream, why can't I? Why not? Now, what he does is he does a full participatory thing where the chat votes on every decision, and they have a whole, you know, one of his mods does the dice rolling and all this stuff where the whole chat basically participates in playing the book with him. I'm not going to be doing that, mostly because I will not typically have enough people in my chat to do that. I'm just going to make the decisions myself and go through it and play it as though I'm playing a single-player computer game. But of course, it's not a game, it's just a book. I'm just going to be reading the whole time. But somebody has put these old Lone Wolf books up on the internet in a nice digital format to read them. And they have a program, a browser-based program here called StatsKeeper that actually you can use to do all the tracking automated the combat and all the roles and stuff right there in the browser alongside the text of the book. So I'm going to be basically showing you that, reading, using the StatKeeper program to do the gameplay elements, and we're just going to go through these books, or at least the first one here, and see how it goes. So there are 20-something of these Lone Wolf books. I didn't actually ever read all of them. I only got through about maybe a dozen back in the old days when I was a kid. So I'm excited to see all the later ones. But, you know, it's been many, many years since I read these books. I mean, many years. So I hardly remember them. I just remember that I loved them. So let's go ahead and do this then. I've got some music in the background. I've put together a playlist of 27 songs. All of them are by Kevin MacLeod, also known as Incompetech from Incompetech.com. He's a really well-known on YouTube musician, writer of music, creator of music, because he creates all of his music under a Creative Commons attribution license, which means it's royalty-free. So people use Kevin MacLeod's music in tons of videos on YouTube because they can use his songs for free. And that's why I have his music in the background here. So I've put together a playlist of 27 of his songs with kind of a fantasy theme. And that's what I've got for the music. So credit for all music you hear anytime during this. It's all Kevin MacLeod. Incompetech.com. So, and of course there'll be a link to that in the description. I want to make sure he gets full credit for his music. So here's the little intro I'm going to read for you for this first book, and then we'll get into explaining how the rules work and go forth from there. You are Lone Wolf. In a devastating attack, the Dark Lords have destroyed the monastery where you were learning the skills of the Kai Lords. You are the sole survivor. In flight from the dark, you swear revenge. But first, you must reach Holmgard to warn the king of the gathering evil. Relentlessly, the servants of darkness hunt you across your country, and every turn of the page presents a new challenge. Choose your skills and your weapons carefully, for they can help you succeed in the most fantastic and terrifying journey of your life. And then it goes into a whole thing about Joe Dever. He's the guy that wrote all the Lone Wolf books, and also the guy that gave permission for them to be reproduced digitally online for free for everyone. And then Gary Chalk was the illustrator. There's a lot of black and white cool illustrations throughout these books, and he's the one that did those. So let me give you a quick look at what the cover of this book looked like. Now, there were many different covers because it was published different places at different times, but this was the cover that I had. The original American release cover back in the 80s. And I remember this brings back so many memories for me, just seeing this again, this cover. This was book one, Flight from the Dark, and it really got me started on loving Lone Wolf and going into an exciting Lone Wolf journey that all begins here. Alright, so we're going to go through here. Just a dedication, it's to Melon Yin. This is where Joe Dever and Project Aeon, that's the group that created these digital browser-based versions of the books. They kind of talk about that there. There's some credits. The story so far, we will actually come back to in a moment. So then it gets into the game rules. Now, I have already made my character. I've gone through and made my character. I have my everything done here. And I'm not going to go through and read everything of the rules to you, because that would take a long time and wouldn't be very interesting. But basically, I'll explain it real quick. You have two stats. You have combat skill and endurance. Combat skill just represents how good you are at fighting, and it's the only stat that's really used in a comparative way in the combat system. You use your combat skill compared to the combat skill of your enemy, and then you generate random numbers. And the Stats Keeper program, as you can see here, I can roll random numbers by clicking on this, between 0 and 9. In the original books, you had to use this. This table was in the back of the book, and you had to, like, do a thing where you kind of, like, closed your eyes and, like, randomly just, like, pointed with a pencil or something and saw what number it fell on. And that was how you generated the random numbers. But now I don't have to do that. I can just use this program and it'll give me a random number. The other thing is endurance, which is essentially just hit points. It's just an amount of health that you have. You take damage to your endurance, and when it goes to zero, you're dead. That's all that is. The Kai disciplines. Now, I will read to you the ones that I chose. I'm not going to read all of them. Kai disciplines. Over the centuries, the Kai monks have mastered the skills of the warrior. These skills are known as the Kai disciplines, and they are taught to all Kai lords. You have learnt only 5 of the skills listed below. The choice of which 5 skills these are is for you to make. As all of the disciplines may be of use to you at some point on your perilous quest, pick your 5 with care. The correct use of a discipline at the right time can save your life. And as you can see, there are a bunch of different ones. And here they are shown on my stats keeper over here. But I chose my 5. The 5 I chose are camouflage. This discipline enables a Kai Lord to blend in with his surroundings. In the countryside, he can hide undetected among trees and rocks and pass close to an enemy without being seen. In a town or city, it enables him to look and sound like a native of that area, and can help him to find shelter or a safe hiding place. I chose that one. I chose hunting. This skill ensures that a Kai Lord will never starve in the wild. He will always be able to hunt for food for himself, except in areas of wasteland and desert. This skill also enables a Kai Lord to be able to move stealthily when stalking his prey. So I'm kind of going for a whole stealth ranger sort of theme here. I also chose Sixth Sense. This skill may warn a Kai Lord of imminent danger. It may also reveal the true purpose of a stranger or strange object encountered in your adventure. I remember Sixth Sense being extremely useful, because lots of times this game, these books try to trick you, and a lot of things can just instantly kill you if you choose wrong. But if you have Sixth Sense, a lot of times it will warn you ahead of time, so you don't make the wrong choice. I also chose Tracking. This skill enables a Kai Lord to make the correct choice of a path in the wild, to discover the location of a person or object in a town or city, and to read the secrets of footprints or tracks. And finally, I chose Healing. This discipline can be used to restore endurance points lost in combat. If you possess this skill, you may restore one endurance point to your total for every numbered section of the book you pass through in which you're not involved in combat. So, those are the five that I chose. Now, the way that what's cool about the Lone Wolf series compared to a lot of other game book series that they had, a lot of them were just each book was a standalone thing and they had no relation to one another. What I loved about the Lone Wolf series is it's one setting, it's one story, it's one character going through the entire thing. So all the books form like one continuous story, and you carry your same character over with your stats and your equipment and everything. And each book that you complete, you basically gain a rank as a Kai, and you get to choose another ability. So when I complete this book, I'll get to choose one more of these for the next book, and then I get to choose another one for the... And eventually you become a Magna Kai and a Grandmaster, and you get whole new sets of abilities. But basically, you level up, essentially, from book to book, which is really cool. The other ones I didn't choose are Weapon Skill, Mind Shield, Mind Blast, Animal Kinship, Mind Over Matter. Those are the ones I did not choose. For now. And this just tells you you carry over your stuff to the next book, which is called Fire on the Water. Alright, equipment. You are dressed in the green tunic and cloak of a Kai initiate. You have little with you to arm yourself for survival. All you possess is an axe. And as you can see, I have axe listed here under my weapons. And a backpack containing one meal. See, I have a meal written here under my backpack. Your backpack can hold 8 items maximum. Each meal counts as one item of its own. I also have hanging from my waist a leather pouch containing gold crowns. Here under records, I rolled and I got 7 gold crowns. You discover amongst the smoky ruins of the monastery a map of Somerland, showing the capital city of Homeguard and the land of Durinor far to the west, or far to the east. I'm just making up directions now. I guess I could read what it says on the screen instead of just, you know, like writing my own book here. You place the map inside your tunic for safety. And here's the map. I remember this map from the physical books. You can't see it very well at this size, so let's blow it up a bit. So this is the map of the Last Lands, being the Free Kingdoms of Northern Magnamund. And you see some different banners there. There is the war banner of the Kai Lords of Somerland. Somerland is up here. It's this little country. There's the Kai Monastery. This is where you start the game. There's Homeguard, which is where you're trying to get to. Doesn't look like it's very far on this map, but you know, I don't know what the scale is, but it's a pretty big map. And then, of course, there's a much larger area here of all these other places, and you go to some or all of them in other books. And this, even this whole map here, is only a small piece of the whole continent in the world. So anyway, there's the map. Kind of cool. And then you also find one of the following, and it's a random roll. And I rolled, and I got a helmet. So it adds 2 endurance points to my total. There's helmet listed there. And there, under my endurance, 24 is what I got for my actual endurance. Then I have 2 points from that helmet, giving me a total of 26. This explains what you can carry and how much you can carry of each thing and all of that. Then there's something called special items. They're not carried in the backpack. The book will tell you. It says you can only carry 50 crowns. That's the money. You can only carry 8 items in your backpack. You can only carry 2 weapons. And it tells you how you use the different items, basically the rules for each thing. Food, if you don't have food when instructed to eat, you lose endurance. But if you have hunting, which I do, you don't have to tick off a meal when instructed to eat, which is nice. Then it tells you the rules for combat. Now, the way combat essentially worked in the books is, like I said, you would compare your weapon skill to the weapon skill or combat skill to that of the enemy. That would give you a number. Then you would generate a random number, and then you would use this crazy looking chart. This is the combat results table. Here it is. And you would, you know, you would, this would be your number up here of your ratio compared, you're comparing the two weapon skills, and then this would be the number you generated randomly. And whatever you got on the chart shows how much damage the enemy takes and how much damage Lone Wolf takes. And you would do this over and over until one or the other is dead. And that's how it works. But in this game, I have an automated system here in StatsKeeper where I just have to put in the enemy's numbers, and then I click this button, and it rolls a round of combat and automatically deducts the endurance for me, so we don't have to use this chart or do any math or anything. Which is kind of cool. And you can evade combat sometimes, it'll let you. Alright, then there's the levels of Kai training. This just shows you the names of the ranks. This is based on how many of the powers you know. Since we know 5, we start off as an initiate. Each book that we go through will gain another one and we'll have a higher and higher rank. Beyond the 10 basic skills of the Kai Master await the secrets of the higher Kai disciplines, or Magna Kai. By acquiring the wisdom of the Magna Kai, a Kai Lord can progress toward the ultimate achievement and become a Kai Grandmaster. Kai Wisdom. Your mission will be one of great danger, for the Dark Lords and their servants are a cruel and fierce enemy who give and expect no mercy. Use the map to help you steer a correct course for the capital. Make notes as you progress through the story, for they will be of great help in future adventures. Many things that you find will aid you during the adventure. Some special items will be of use in future Lone Wolf adventures, and others may be red herrings of no real use at all, so be selective in what you decide to keep. There are many routes to the king, but only one involves a minimum of danger. With a wise choice of Kai disciplines and a great deal of courage, any player should be able to complete the mission, no matter how weak their initial combat skill or endurance point score. The honor and memory of the Kai Lords will go with you on your perilous journey. Good luck. I will tell you, it is very possible and likely to die going through this. You can make a wrong choice and get instantly killed, or you can easily lose a fight and get killed that way. Whenever I die, I'm just going to go back and immediately, you know, go back to the thing right before I died and be able to make a choice, as if I'm saving a game in a, you know, in a computer game. All right, so this is the first actual section of the book, but before we go to that, now it is time to read the story so far. Now the story itself proper is going to begin. The story so far. In the northern land of Sommerland, it has been the custom for many centuries to send the children of the warrior lords to the monastery of Kai. There they are taught the skills and disciplines of their noble fathers. The Kai monks are masters of their art, and the children in their charge love and respect them in spite of the hardships of their training. For one day, when they have finally learnt the secret skills of the Kai, they will return to their homes equipped in mind and body to defend themselves against the constant threat of war from the Dark Lords of the West. In olden times, during the Age of the Black Moon, the Dark Lords waged war on Sommerland. The conflict was a long and bitter trial of strength that ended in victory for the Somlending at the Great Battle of Machangorge. King Ulnar and the allies of Durinor broke the Dark Lord armies at the Pass of Moytura and forced them back into the bottomless abyss of Machangorge. Vashna, mightiest of the Dark Lords, was slain upon the sword of King Ulnar, called Sommersword, the Sword of the Sun. Since that age, the Dark Lords have vowed vengeance upon Sommerland and the House of Ulnar. Now, it is in the morning of the Feast of Femarn, when all of the Kai Lords are present at the monastery for the celebrations. Suddenly, a great black cloud comes from out of the western skies. So many are the numbers of the black-winged beast that fill the sky that the sun is completely hidden. The Dark Lords, ancient enemy of the Somlending, are attacking. War has begun. On this fateful morning, you, Silent Wolf, the name given to you by the Kai, have been sent to collect firewood in the forest as a punishment for your inattention in class. As you are preparing to return, you see to your horror a vast cloud of black leathery creatures swoop down and engulf the monastery. Dropping the wood, you race to the battle that has already begun. But in the unnatural dark, you stumble and strike your head on a low tree branch. As you lose consciousness, the last thing that you see in the poor light are the walls of the monastery crashing to the ground. Many hours pass before you awake. With tears in your eyes, you now survey the scene of destruction. Raising your face to the clear sky, you swear vengeance on the Dark Lords for the massacre of the Kai warriors, and with a sudden flash of realization, you know what you must do. You must set off on a perilous journey to the capital city to warn the king of the terrible threat that now faces his people, for you are now the last of the Kai. You are now the Lone Wolf. And from there, we begin our adventure proper. You must make haste, for you sense it is not safe to linger by the smoking remains of the ruined monastery. The black-winged beast could return at any moment. You must set out for the Somlending capital of Holmgard and tell the king the terrible news of the massacre, that the whole elite of Kai warriors, save yourself, has been slaughtered. Without the Kai lords to lead her armies, Somerland will be at the mercy of their ancient enemy, the Dark Lords. Fighting back tears, you bid farewell to your dead kinsmen. Silently, you promise that their deaths will be avenged. You turn away from the ruins and carefully descend the steep track. At the foot of the hill, the path splits into two directions, both leading into a large wood. So I can use my Kai discipline of Sixth Sense, I can take the right path into the wood, or I can follow the left track. Well, of course, I do have Sixth Sense, so I'm going to use it. Your Sixth Sense has warned you that some of the creatures that attack the monastery are searching the two paths for any survivors of their raid. But you can avoid both tracks by making your way through the undergrowth of the woods. I'm going to cut through the heavier foliage toward the northeast, avoiding the tracks, because there's a lot of enemies out here and I don't want them to kill me. You have cut your way through the thick undergrowth for nearly half an hour when you hear the beat of wings high above the trees. Looking up, you can just make out the shape of a Kron approaching from the north. It is one of the monsters that attacked the monastery, and on its back are two gray-skinned creatures armed with long spears. These are mountain Geaks, evil servants of the Dark Lords, full of hatred and malice. Many centuries ago, their ancestors were used by the Dark Lords to build the infernal city of Helgadad, which lies in the volcanic wastelands beyond the Durncrag range of mountains. The construction of the city was long and torturous, and only the strongest of the Geaks survived the heat and poisonous atmosphere of Helgadad. Hidden by the trees, you freeze, keeping absolutely still as the Kron passes overhead and disappears toward the south. When you are sure that it has gone, you move off once again into the forest. You have covered about a quarter of a mile when you hear shouting and a noise like thunderclaps ahead. Edging nearer, you soon make out a clearing that you recognize to be the site of the ruins of Raumas, an ancient forest temple. A war party of Geaks, some 25 to 30 strong, are attacking the ruins from all sides. Many more of the Geaks are dead or dying among the broken pillars of marble, but still they assault whatever is hidden inside. Suddenly, a bolt of blue lightning rips through the front rank of Geaks, sending the armor-clad creatures tumbling in all directions. A Geak, taller than the others and dressed from head to foot in black chainmail, curses at his troops as he whips them forward with a barbed flail. With weapon ready, you move to the edge of the clearing, under cover of the thick foliage, and try to catch a glimpse of the defenders. To your amazement, the ruins are being defended by a young man no older than yourself. You recognize his sky-blue robes embroidered with stars. He is a young Thurgist of the Magician's Guild of Torin, an apprentice in magic. And we can blow this picture up. Here's one of those Gary Chalk illustrations. So we see this, we've met this wizard here, and there's a Giyak up on the pillar. An apprentice of magic. Five Giyaks charge forward, their spears raised to stab the apprentice as he hurriedly retreats deeper into the ruins. You see him turn and raise his left hand, just before a bolt of blue flame shoots from his fingertips into the snarling Giyak soldiers. Close to where you are hidden, you see a Giyak scuttle past and climb one of the pillars of the temple. He has a long, curved dagger in his mouth, and he is about to jump on the young wizard standing below. I can shout a warning to the wizard. I can run forward and attack the Giyak when he jumps. I can pick up a chunk of temple marble and throw it at the Giyak's head. Or I can just leave. I'm feeling bold. I'm gonna run forward and attack the Giyak. Just as the Giyak makes his leap, you race forward and strike out with your weapon, knocking the creature away from the young wizard's back. You jump onto the struggling Giyak and strike again. Due to the surprise of your attack, add 4 points to your combat skill for the duration of this fight, but remember to deduct it again as soon as the fight is over. So now we actually have a fight. So I put in combat skill 9. A single Giyak is quite weak. There are much, much tougher enemies. And I temporarily make my combat skill 19. I'll have to change it back after the battle. Enemy has 9 and 9. So then, as you see, I have 26 endurance, the enemy has 9. I hit click battle, and it will automatically... It only took one round. Wow! And I didn't lose any endurance. Of course, I did have 10 more points of combat skill than that, which means, you know, the odds were extremely good for me. So, I one-shotted that Giyak. I just ran forward, boom! Cut his head off, called it a day. Usually, the fights will not go that well. Let me lower my combat skill back down to 15 like it's supposed to be. If you win, turn to 325. Upon seeing you emerge from the woods, the Giyak officer shouts, "Ogot! Ogot!" to his cowering troops, who flee the ruins and run to the safety of the forest. Shaking his mailed fist at you, the black-clad Giyak screams, "Hranek Rogagak! Orgadaka Okeg Rogagaj!" before leaving. Surveying the scene of battle, you count over 15 Giyak dead lying among the broken pillars of Raumas. The young wizard wipes his brow and walks towards you, his hand extended in friendship. He is a young blonde-haired youth with deep, brooding eyes. His face is lined with exhaustion and the grime of battle, and his long sky-blue robes bear evidence of living rough in the wilds. He shakes your hand and bows. "My eternal thanks, Sky Lord. My powers are nearly drained. Had you not come to my aid, I fear I would have ended my days atop a Giyak lance." He is weak and unsteady on his feet. You take his arm and sit him down upon a fallen pillar where you listen intently to what he has to say. "My name is Baindan. I am journeyman to the Brotherhood of the Crystal Star, which is the Magician's Guild of Torin. My guildmaster has sent me to your monastery with this urgent message." He removes a vellum envelope from inside his robes and hands it to you. "As you see, I have opened the letter and read its contents. When the war started, I was on the highway with 2 traveling companions. The Kron attacked us, and we lost each other in the forest during our escape." The letter is a warning to the Kai Lords that the Dark Lords have mustered a vast army beyond the Durncrag Range. The Guildmaster urges the Kai to cancel the celebrations of Famarn and prepare for war. "I fear we were betrayed," says Baindan, his head bowed in sorrow. "One of my order, a brother called Vonatar, had explored the forbidden mysteries of the black art. 10 days ago, he denounced the Brotherhood and killed one of our elders. He has since disappeared. It is rumored that he now aids the Dark Lords. You tell Bandon what has happened at the monastery and of your mission to warn the king. Silently, he removes a gold chain from around his neck and hands it to you. On the chain is a small crystal star pendant. It is the symbol of my Brotherhood, and we are both truly brothers in this hour of darkness. It is a talisman of good fortune. May it protect you on your road ahead. You thank him, place the chain around your neck, and slip the crystal star inside your shirt. Bainden bids you farewell.
We must leave this place, lest the Geaks return with more of their loathsome kind to put an end to us. I must return to my guild. I bid you farewell, my brother. May the luck of the gods go with you.
And it says, later books assume that you keep the crystal star pendant and ask you if you possess it to see if you've ever met Bainden. It also may or may not be useful in other situations. You may decide whether or not to keep the pendant. Well, I'm definitely keeping the pendant. Crystal star pendant. Hold on to that. Okay, moving forward. To take these little pauses to drink some water here, because this is a lot of talking. With a wave of his hand, Bandon leaves the ruins, and you continue your mission, pushing on through the thick woods ahead. You have not gone far when you realize several pairs of yellow eyes are watching you from the undergrowth to your left. Suddenly, a black arrow skims the top of your head. It is a Geaak ambush, and you must run as fast as you can to escape it. As you race through the trees, you can hear the horrible cackle of the Geaks close behind you. Soon the trees start to thin out, and directly ahead, you can see a rocky hillside. Will I break cover and climb up the hill, or will I change direction and continue my run through the forest? I believe I will break cover and climb up the hill. At least up at the top of the hill, I'll be able to fight from an advantage position if I need to. The hillside is steep, and the earth is loose and slippery. You chance a swift glance over your shoulder and see the two Geaks emerge from the woods. They start to climb after you. About halfway from the peak of the hill, you spot a cave to your right, almost totally hidden by a landslide. I can hide in the cave, I can avoid the cave and continue climbing, or I can use my Kai discipline of camouflage, which I have, so I'm going to use that. You pull off your hood and drop down behind the rocks that litter the mouth of the cave. Holding your breath, you curl up into a tight ball and completely cover yourself with your green cloak. Only a few minutes later, the Geaks clamber over the rocky ledge outside, their evil yellow eyes furtively searching every crevice of the hillside. Then, cursing in their strange tongue, they leave the ledge and start to climb towards the peak. You silently thank your old masters for teaching you the Kai discipline of camouflage. It has probably saved your life on this occasion. Explore the cave, or leave and descend the hill? Well, I gotta explore the cave, right? The floor of the cave is quite dry and dusty. As you explore deeper in the half-light, you detect the stale odor of rotting flesh. Littering a crevice are the bones, fur, and teeth of several small animals. You notice a small cloth bag among these remains, which you open to discover 3 gold crowns. Pocketing these coins, you leave what appears to be the lair of a mountain cat and carefully descend the hill. So go in here, and now I have 10 crowns. And we'll move forward. You reach the base of the hill and hurry into the forest. After only a few minutes, you discover an old forest track. Will I follow it north, or will I follow it east? Gosh, that's a tough call. I think east is more towards the direction of where I'm headed, though, according to the map. You walk for over an hour, during which time you keep a constant vigil for any sign of Kron in the sky above. You have twice spotted their telltale shadows in the sky, and on both occasions your quick wits have saved you from capture. You are now very hungry and must eat a meal. I have the Kai discipline of hunting, so I don't have to mark off a meal. I can just automatically, assuming I've captured some or killed some small animal that I can eat, and continue on my journey. The path soon ends at a large clearing. In the center of the clearing is a tree much taller and wider than any others you have seen in the forest. Looking up through the massive branches, you can see a large treehouse, some 25 to 30 feet above the ground. There is no ladder, but the gnarled bark of the tree offers many footholds. And there's a picture of a treehouse. Climb the tree and search the treehouse, or press on? I'm climbing the tree. There's a picture of what we see inside. Pushing open the treehouse door, you see an old hermit huddled in the corner of the small cabin. So this guy is huddled in there looking afraid. Your climb is swift and easy. It reminds you of the many trees that you climbed and explored near Torin as a child, when you wanted to pick fruit or to look out over the beautiful countryside of Sommerland. Pushing open the treehouse door, you see an old hermit huddled in the corner of the small cabin. A look of great relief spreads across his face as he recognizes your green Kai cloak. He tells you that this area is full of Geaks, and that he has counted over 40 Kron flying over his home in the last 3 hours. They were heading east. He scurries over to a cupboard and returns with a plate of fresh fruit. You thank him and place the fruit in your backpack. There is enough for one meal. The hermit also produces a fine warhammer and lays it upon a table by the door.
"Your need is greater than mine, Kai Lord," he says. "Please take this trusty warhammer if you so wish."
You may take this weapon only if you exchange it for another weapon already in your possession, for it is the only defense that the hermit has against the enemy. Thanking the old man, you carefully descend the tree and continue on your mission. Well, I think I'm okay with my axe. I'm gonna let him keep his warhammer. But I will take that meal. That's two meals now. Even though I don't need meals, I'm holding on to them in case I can give them away. You know, somebody else might need food and I could give them a meal or something like that. Okay, moving on. You have been trudging through the forest for nearly 2 hours. The nagging fear that you are lost begins to seem a reality. Apart from the occasional cry of a Kron in the far distance, you have seen or heard no evidence that the enemy is in this part of the forest. As you descend a rocky hillock, you see something unusual in the tangled woods ahead. Surrounded by thorny briars and closely packed roots, you see the entrance of a tunnel disappearing into the hillside beyond. It is approximately 7 feet in height and just over 10 feet wide. As you get closer, you can feel a slight breeze coming from the inky blackness. If the other end of this tunnel emerges on the far side of the hill, it could save you many hours of difficult climbing, but it could also harbor unknown danger. And there's the picture of the heavily wooded tunnel entrance. Enter the tunnel, climb the hillside. I'm not really feeling this tunnel. I think I should climb the hillside instead. I've had good luck climbing things so far. As you begin your climb, you hear the beat of wings approaching from the west. Kron! By the noise they are making, you estimate there are at least 10, perhaps more. You curse your bad luck, for the hillside offers no cover from the sky. If you are attacked during this difficult climb, you will find it nearly impossible to fight back and remain upright at the same time. I can draw my weapon and remain completely still in the hope that the Kron will not spot me, or I can quickly descend the hillside and take cover in the tunnel. Well, I'm gonna hope they don't spot me. Within a few minutes, you can see the Kron hovering over a hilltop behind you. At a quick count, you can make out at least 16 of these horrible creatures, each of which has at least 2 Geaks riding upon its back. They are armed with long spears and wear tall, pointed helmets of dull bronze. You hear the excited grunts of the Geaks. They have spotted you. You jump for the entrance of the tunnel some 25 feet below, but your boot gets caught in a thorny briar, and you hang helplessly upside down, weaponless and vulnerable. Fortunately for you, the end is swift. As the first Geak lance pierces your heart, death is instantaneous. Your life and your mission end here. So I have now died for the first time. Apparently that was not a wise choice. So we will go back and we will make the other choice. If you decide to quickly descend the hillside and take cover in the tunnel is dark and the air is much cooler than outside. You carefully advance with one hand on the tunnel wall to aid your sense of direction. You have been in total darkness for 3 minutes when you detect the foul smell of decay ahead, similar to rotting meat. If you have a torch and tinderbox in your pack, you may light the torch to see your way ahead. I don't have a torch. Suddenly, something heavy drops from the tunnel ceiling onto your back, and you fall to your knees. It is a burrow crawler, and you must fight it, for it is trying to strangle you with its long, slimy tentacles. And that is what the burrow crawler looks like. This looks like a carrion crawler from D&D. Like a worm body with like a segmented front body with legs and then a head with all the tentacles coming out of it. It's very creepy. It's a burrow crawler. It's trying to strangle you. Life isn't good. And I have to fight it. If you do not have a torch, deduct 3 points from your combat skill during this fight. The burrow crawler is immune to mind blast and animal kinship, neither of which I have. Okay, so for this fight, it's going to be much tougher. Look at his combat skill. It's 17. And I have to lower mine by 3. Mine's only going to be 12, so this time the burrow crawler has a big advantage over me. So we will do this battle here. Alright, let's see what happens. I have 26, it has 7. I lost 5, it lost 3. I lost none and it died. Okay, that went pretty well. That went pretty well. 2 rounds, killed it, only lost 5 endurance total. I can live with that. Now I return my combat skill to what it's supposed to be. I won. Yay! The slimy creature lets out a long, ghastly death cry and collapses. You are near to panic and scramble to your feet, grabbing what you think to be your belt from the jaws of the dead beast. You can see light in the far distance, and you sprint for it as fast as you can. When you finally emerge into the daylight, you fall onto the leafy ground and fight for breath in painful gasps. Slowly sitting upright, you notice that you are still wearing your belt. You had not lost it after all. What you grabbed from the jaw of the burrow crawler was a leather strap with a small pouch and a sheathed dagger halfway along it. You break open the clasp to find it contains 20 gold crowns. You may take both the dagger and the crowns if you are able to. Feeling a little better now, you gather your equipment together and push on eastwards into the forest. So I will take those things. Now I have... Wow, I'm loaded with money now. I have 30 gold crowns. And I'll take that dagger so that I have a backup weapon in case I lose my axe somehow, or I have to give a weapon to somebody or something like that. Moving forward. The forest begins to thin out until finally you can make out a road through the trees ahead. The highway is full of people heading south. Many are wheeling their possessions along on hand carts. I can join the refugees and perhaps learn more of what's happened in the north. Or I can continue to move south, but under the cover of the trees. I feel like I should avoid these people. They seem like more of a distraction to my mission than anything else. Sticking in the cover of the trees sounds better. Because if the refugees get attacked by Kron or something, and Giax, then I'm going to feel compelled to try to defend them, and I might end up in a fight with more stuff than I can beat, and, you know, in general, I have a mission to get complete, so I'm going to continue to go south and stay in the trees. You have been traveling for about a mile when you notice two legs sticking out from behind a large boulder. Sixth sense, take a closer look, avoid. We'll use sixth sense, as I will generally always use sixth sense when I have a chance to. Your skill enables you to recognize the boots and leggings of a king's soldier. You can sense that the man is wounded and in need of help. Oh, by the way, wait, I need to see something. All right, 1, 2, 3, 4. Every numbered section I go through, I get a point of endurance back because of my healing. He's wounded and in need of help, so I will aid him. And now my endurance is back up to full. Healing is a really good ability to take. You cautiously peer around the rock to see a soldier lying on his back. By his side is a spear and shield. On the shield is the painting of a white Pegasus, the Prince of Sommerlin's emblem. He is one of the Prince's soldiers, and he is only just conscious. His uniform is badly torn, and you can see that he has a deep wound in his left arm. As you move nearer, his eyes flicker open.
"Heal me, my lord," he begs. "I can barely feel my arm."
I do have the Kai discipline of healing. If I didn't have it, I wouldn't be able to help him. But I do, so I'm going to use it. Placing one hand on his forehead and the other on his wounded arm, you feel the warmth of your healing powers leave your body and give strength to the injured man. He tells you his name is Trimis, and he is a soldier in Prince Pelathar's army. The prince and his troops are engaged in battle to the south, where a large force of the Dark Lord's creatures are attacking the Bridge of Alima. During the fight, he has been snatched into the air by a Kron and dropped into the forest. You make the soldier as comfortable as possible before continuing on your mission. You have not gone far when you hear the sound of battle to the west. I'm not going to follow the sound to the battle. I'm going to continue south. In the distance, you can hear the sound of horses galloping nearer. You crouch behind a tree and wait as the riders come closer. They are the cavalry of the King's Guard, wearing the white uniforms of His Majesty's army. Call them, let them pass, and continue my way. Well, I'll talk to them. The King's Guard. I am trying to get to the king, after all. The officer orders his men to halt and asks you your business. You tell him who you are and how the monastery has been destroyed. He is deeply saddened to hear your news. He offers you a horse and asks you to accompany him to Prince Pelathar, the king's son. That sounds great. That sounds perfect. A horse. Yeah, let's go see the prince. This is sounding like the way forward. Ahead of you, you can see a fierce battle raging across a stone bridge. The clash of steel and the cries of men and beasts echo through the forest. In the midst of the fighting, you see Prince Pelathar, the king's son. He is in combat with a large gray Gorgaz, who is wielding a black axe above his scaly head. Suddenly, the prince falls wounded, a black arrow in his side. So there is the Gorgaz. That looks like... I mean, look how much bigger he is than the... There's the Giax. He's all scaly and huge, and there's this great, huge black axe. The clash of steel and the cries of men and beasts echo through the forest. This looks pretty serious. If you wish to defend the fallen prince, or run into the forest. Well, I can't just let the prince die. The creature that you now face is a Gorgaz, one of a race of cold-blooded reptilian creatures that dwell deep in the treacherous Mackenmeyer swamps. Their favorite food is human flesh. The prince's sword lies at your feet. You may pick up and use this weapon if you wish.
The Gorgaz is about to strike at you. You must fight him to the death. This creature is immune to mind blast. All right, so look at how tough the Gorgaz is. Combat skill 20, endurance 30. I mean, this thing is a beast. It's way better than me. Its combat skill is 5 points higher than mine, and it has more endurance than me. So, I could very easily get killed here. Could very easily get killed. Let's do it, though. 20 combat skill, 30 endurance. All right, here we go. Round one. I lost 4, it lost 4. Round two. I lost 5, it only lost 2. Round three. Oh, I lost none, it lost a shitload. It lost like 9, and I lost none. That was a good round. I got lucky there. Alright, 17, 15. 17 is 7, I lost none again! And it lost 8. Oh, those last two rounds, I just rallied, seriously. I think I'm gonna beat it now. 17 and 7. 13 and 3, okay, I lost 4, it lost 4. And I lost none and it died! Yes! Okay, now I lost half my endurance there, but I beat that very tough creature. So that's exciting. End and save. Win. Turn to 82. Yay! Gorgaz defeated.
The giant Gorgaz lies dead at your feet. His evil followers hiss at you and then fall back from the bridge. The prince's soldiers form a protective wall around you and their dying leader with their shields. Black arrows whistle past your head. The dying prince looks up into your eyes and says,
"Kai Lord, you must take a message to my father. The enemy is too strong. We cannot hold him. The king must seek that which is in Durinor, or all is lost. Take my horse and ride for the capital. May the luck of the gods ride with you."
You bid a sad farewell to the prince, mount his white steed, and head south along the forest path. The battle still rages behind you as the prince's men fight off another assault on the bridge.
So the prince gave me his own horse. Well, that should really help me getting to the king. All right, let's go. Hold on. All right. 14. 15. Gotta remember my healing every time.
The prince's horse is indeed a magnificent animal, fast and sure of foot. You gallop along the twisting track as if it were a straight highway until the noise of battle has disappeared far behind you. You are hungry and must eat a meal during your ride.
No problem, got hunting.
After several miles, the path stops abruptly at a junction. There is a signpost, but it has been hacked down.
I could turn left or right, or I can use my Kai discipline of tracking, another one that I chose. I feel like I chose the best 5, honestly. The others are useful less often. I mean, weapon skill and mind blast help you in combat, but the others are used less often. The ones I picked come up pretty often, and they seem to have been pretty critical so far. Tracking, go. Wait. Hold on, so I had 13 here. 14, 15, okay. 16.
Your tracking ability tells you that several trails from the right path lead off in the direction of the left path. They have been made by large wolves. The Dark Lords use such beasts to scout for their armies. They are vicious creatures and are often ridden by Geax. The left path leads towards Holmgard, and the right path leads off towards the Durncrag Mountains. The choice of route is yours. Well, toward the Durncrag Mountains is toward where all the Dark Lords are. Holmgard is where I'm actually trying to get to, so obviously the left path is the way to go. You have ridden about 3 miles when, in the distance, you spot the unmistakable silhouette of 5 large Doom Wolves. Riding on their backs are Geax. They seem to be going on ahead to where the path leads down into an open meadow. Suddenly, one of the Geax leaves the others and begins to ride back along the path towards you.
I got 17 endurance. I can hide or I can fight him. Fuck it!
taking him out. You gallop forward. Oh yeah, I got a horse. Bring it. Mounted combat. Let's go. You gallop forward to meet the oncoming Doomwolf and Rider, your weapon raised to strike. The Giak sees you and unsheathes his scimitar. You must fight both Giak and Doomwolf as one enemy. Alright. No problem. There's 14 combat skill and 24 endurance. I'm not worried about it so much. Alright, round one. I lost 5, he lost 4. Round 2. I lost 2. He lost a bunch, like 9. 10 and 11. I lost 3. He lost 6. This is coming down to it, though. My endurance is getting pretty fucking low here. Next round. Yes, I lost none, and he died. So the Giak and the Doomwolf, slain. My endurance is looking bad, though. I need to avoid some fighting for a little while until I heal up. 93. Alright, endurance goes up to 8. The beast and its rider lie dead. You notice a scroll tucked into the Giak's belt. You may take this if you wish, but remember to mark it on your action chart. The other Doom Wolves are charging along the path towards you. Alright, let's take this scroll. And I will try to escape into the woods, because if I fought these Doom Wolves now, I would definitely lose. You ride deeper and deeper into the forest. Silently, you thank the prince for such a fine horse, for although the ground is a tangle of briars and roots, he never once falters. The Doom Wolves are soon left far behind, and you bring your horse to a halt. The light has faded fast, and it is almost night. Press on ahead or bear left? I'll press on ahead. You have covered about 2 miles when the trees ahead thin out. You can see a small wooden shack on the edge of a lake. A cloaked man approaches you and offers to row you and your horse across the lake for a fee of 2 gold crowns. See, that sounds pretty good. But since I have 6 cents, I can find out if this guy's on the up and up or not. Hold on. Fucked up again. 9, 10, 6 cents. I gotta remember that. You sense something is wrong. With fighting all around and the forces of the Dark Lord so near, why has this man stayed in the forest? You feel a strange aura of evil about him and decline his offer. Ah, seems that the guy was not okay. Glad I didn't accept his offer. Probably would have drowned me. Night falls and you are soon engulfed in total darkness. To press on would be useless, for you would be sure to lose your way. Tethering your horse to a tree, you pull your green Kai cloak about you and fall into a restless sleep. You are awoken by the sound of troops in the distance. Across the lake, you see the black-cloaked figure of Drakarim and a pack of Doom Wolves and their riders. A Kron appears from above the trees and lands on the roof of the small wooden shack. It is ridden by a creature dressed in red. The Kron takes off and begins to fly across the lake to where you are hidden. Fight it? Nah, not feeling that right now. Sounds like this thing is tough. And I only have 13 endurance. Ride deeper in the forest or use camouflage? I'm going to use camouflage. 14. You coax the horse to lie down and begin to cover him and yourself with branches and dead leaves. You hear the wings of the Kron as it passes over the trees. It returns and circles above you, but soon retreats back across the lake. You decide to leave now in case it returns with some of its friends. As you push on into the forest, you hear the wings of the Kron pass above the trees and disappear northwards. You ride on for nearly an hour until you come to a clearing. On the far side is a track that leads off to the south. Enter the clearing, take the south exit, skirt the edge of the clearing, and pick up the track further on. I'll take the south exit. Oh shit. Oh shit. This isn't gonna go well. Without warning, a terrible apparition in red robes swoops down from the sky on the back of a Kron. Its cry freezes your blood. The beast is a Vordak, a fierce lieutenant of the Dark Lords. He is above you, and you must fight him. There's what a Kron looks like. It's kind of like a pterodactyl, or like a pteranodon, one of the two. And there's the Kron, which is kind of like a Nazgul, I guess. A terrible apparition in red robes swoops down from the sky on the back of a Kron. I might lose here. This is not going to go well, because I only have 15 endurance left. Deduct 2 points from your combat skill unless you have the Kai discipline of Mind Shield, for the creature is attacking you with the power of its mind force as well as with a huge black mace. Alright, this isn't going to go well. I don't have Mind Shield, so my combat skill is only 13, which means he out-combat skills me, and he's got a lot more endurance than me. Just going to have to rely on luck here. Alright. I have 15. He has 25. We both lost 4. Ooh! He lost 9, and I lost none that time. Oh, yes! That might have saved this battle for me. Yes! Yes! He lost, what, 9 again? And I lost none? I must be rolling super high. Alright, that time I lost 4 more, but he died. So I beat him, and I'm back down to 7 endurance. Whew, getting lucky here. Getting lucky on these hard fights. Let's start healing me. My combat skill goes back up to 15, my endurance goes to 8. As the creature dies, its body slowly dissolves into a vile green liquid. You notice that the grass and plants beneath the smoking fluid are beginning to shrivel and die. But a large, valuable-looking gem lies on the ground near to the decaying body. I'll take that gem. The gem feels very hot and burns your hand. Lose 2 endurance points. Shit. But I gain 1 back for a numbered section with healing. You quickly grab it with the edge of your cloak and slip this Vordak gem into your backpack. A gem that size must be worth hundreds of crowns. You smile at your good fortune, mount your horse, and ride off along the south track. Vordak gem. I'll take it. Turn to 118. Heal. You spur your horse to a gallop and race down the long, straight path. In the far distance, you can just make out the silhouette of Holmgard on the horizon, its high walls and tall spires glinting in the morning sun. Your path joins a highway running from north to south. It is the main turnpike road between the northern port of Torin and the capital. You set off towards Holmgard, your eyes peeled for Kron in the clear morning sky. You have ridden several miles and have seen no sign of refugees or of the enemy. You race on towards a high ridge in the middle distance. You should be able to see the capital from there. As you reach the peak, the sight that meets you on the far side is one of hope, but there is still one challenge you know you have to face. There's some banners there, looking cool. Before you are the tall, gray-white walls and glimmering spires of Holmgard, the city's banners fluttering from the battlements in the fresh morning breeze. Stretching out towards the west, the river Eladil traces its course from the mountains of the Durncrag Range to the Holm Gulf. But below the mountain peaks, you can see a vast black army marching relentlessly on towards the capital. To your right, you can see the highway heading off over the rolling plain towards Holmgard. At a gallop, you could make the outer fieldworks of the city's defenses in less than an hour, but you would be in the open for most of the time and vulnerable to attack by Kron. Directly ahead of you, a wide river drifts sluggishly toward the Eladil. If you abandon your horse, you could swim towards the outer defenses under cover of the riverbanks. Or there is a final alternative. To your left lies the graveyard of the ancients. These tombs and crumbling monuments to a forgotten age would conceal your approach, but it is a forbidden area. Many are the unnamed horrors that lie there in restless sleep, waiting to consume the unwary trespasser. Highway, river, or graveyard? Well, highway sounds like a horrible idea. The river also, I'm not a big fan of getting rid of the horse and getting in the water. A lot of bad things can happen there. Of course, the graveyard, probably going to have some scary shit, but it might also have some cool treasure or something. I don't know. I think the Graveyard of the Ancients sounds the most exciting, so we're going there. As you descend the ridge towards the Graveyard of the Ancients, you are aware of a strange mist and cloud that swirls all around this gray and forbidding place, blocking the sun and keeping the graveyard in perpetual gloom. A creeping chill seems to penetrate your very bones. Your horse becomes startled, and no matter how you urge him on, he refuses to go any nearer to this dreadful place. So you must leave your horse and press on by foot. Well, that's unfortunate. Your passage through the graveyard will not be easy, for the ground is broken and covered with a thorny grave weed. This wicked briar tears your cloak and cuts your legs. The air hangs heavy and still. Foul gases seep from open crypts, and the haunting murmur of distant whispering fills your ears. There's the graveyard. Man, that does look like a pretty grim and creepy place. Carefully, you approach a gap between two ancient pillars and part the graveweed with your cloaked hand. Suddenly, the ground collapses beneath you and you fall in a tumble of earth and stone. Dun dun dun. And I heal myself. You are winded, but not hurt. You have fallen 15 feet or so through the roof of an underground tomb. The walls are sheer, and you cannot climb them. An arched tunnel leads out of the tomb towards the east, in front of which lies the sarcophagus of some ancient noble. I'm going to use Sixth Sense here. Your senses scream at you that this place is very evil. Leave as quickly as you can. The walls are dank and slimy. The stale air chokes you, and cobwebs brush across your face. You can feel panic grip your stomach as the tunnel gets darker and darker. You reach a junction where the tunnel meets a corridor leading from north to south. Gosh. No way to know which way to go, so I'm feeling north. Cautiously, you move along the corridor until you come to a sharp eastward turn. A strange greenish light can be seen in the distance. Continue. You descend a flight of stone stairs that lead to a large chamber. A macabre sight awaits you. Directly opposite, across the large wait. What's two more? Directly opposite, across the large stone room, is an ornate archway with a corridor leading into the darkness beyond. The strange green light radiates from two lines of skulls, each resting on a stone plinth. They face each other to form an eerie walkway across the room. Walk across the room or attack the skulls. I don't feel a need to attack the skulls. Maybe I'll just leave them alone and everything will be fine. Oh, I gotta fight something. As you pass each skull, it slowly turns, as if watching your every move. You are halfway across the room when you hear the sharp crack of bones splitting. Suddenly, you see hideous shapes hatching inside the skulls and stretching their wings. 10 slimy winged creatures attacked you, and you must fight them as one enemy. Crypt spawn. Alright, so I've got a horde of slimy winged crypt spawn attacking me. After the first round of combat, I can evade, or if I win the combat. Okay, so let's... So no modifications to my combat skill this time. That's good. Combat skill 16, endurance 16. I'm pretty sure I can win this one. This is a question of how hurt I get doing it. All right, round one. I lost nothing. He lost 10. So I just killed a whole bunch of those things, like, no problem. 17 and 6. I lost nothing. Yes! I killed that thing without taking a point of damage. Awesome. Awesome. I win. And I heal a little more.
As the last of the foul creatures die, so the greenish light starts to fade. You notice that in each of the broken skulls lies a gem. You take these 20 Tomb Guardian gems before darkness engulfs the chamber. Remember to mark these on your action chart as a single backpack item. You quickly leave the dead crypt spawn and press on.
I got all kinds of gems. 20 Tomb Guardian gems. Moving on. Okay, we'll heal a little bit more.
The corridor soon widens into a large hall. At the far end, a stone staircase leads up to a huge door. Two black candles on either side of the stone steps dimly illuminate the chamber. You notice that no mat... What? You notice what? You notice that no wax is melted, and as you get nearer, you can feel that they give off no heat. Ancient engravings cover the stone surfaces of the walls.
And I see this very ornate-looking lock here. That's, pretty serious-looking. An ornate pin appears to lock the door, but there is also a keyhole in the lock plate.
Anxious to leave this evil tomb, you examine the door for a latch. An ornate pin appears to lock the door, but there is also a keyhole in the lock plate.
If you have a golden key, I don't. If you have mind over matter, I don't. Only leaves me one option, to pull out the pin. Endurance goes to 20.
Just as you remove the ornate pin, a loud crack deafens you.
Pick a random number, so here we go. I got a 7. The number is 5 to 9, turn to 317.
Instinctively, you dive away from the stairs and land on the stone floor. Your quick reactions have saved your life, for a vast granite block has fallen from the ceiling and crushed the steps just in front of the lock plate.
Glad to survive that.
Shaken, but still in one piece, you get to your feet. A shaft of dull gray light is seeping into the chamber from above, where the stone block was. Through a hole in the ceiling, you can see a tangle of graveweed and the cloudy sky above. You clamber out of the tomb and head for the arched south gate of the necropolis as fast as possible. The pointed log walls of the city's outer defense works are now visible.
I made it through the graveyard, yay!
At last, you can reach the wooden field works surrounding the outer city. As you race towards a sentry post, you can hear the excited shouts of the guards cheering you on. Thank the gods that they recognize you, for you must appear a ragged and suspicious figure. Your cloak is torn and hangs in tatters, your face is scratched and blood-smeared, and the dust of the graveyard covers you from head to toe. Splashing through a shallow stream, you stagger towards the gate. The full horror of the graveyard encounter begins to catch up with you. The last thing you recall before exhaustion robs you of consciousness is falling into the outstretched arms of two soldiers who have run from the fieldworks to help you. You black out for only a few minutes before you are revived with a measure of strong spirit. Feeling weary but thankful to be alive, you lean on the shoulders of the king's men and you stagger toward the outer defenses. As you reach the walls of the fieldworks, the large oak gates open and you are quickly hurried inside. A sergeant, blood-stained and battle-weary, calls to an officer who turns and recognizes your cloak.
"My lord," he says, "where are the other Kai masters? We're in desperate need of their wisdom. The Dark Lords press us most cruelly and casualties are high."
You inform the brave officer of the terrible fate of your kinsmen and the urgency of your mission to seek the king's counsel. Without saying a word, he motions to a soldier to bring forward two horses. You both mount and gallop off toward the high city wall of Holmgard. Nice, I got a horse again. And an escort now. You reach the main gates of the capital and stare in awe at the height of the city's walls. I made it 200 feet high. Those are some really high walls. The walls of Holmgard have withstood the ravages of both time and the Dark Lords. You and the officer race through the tunnel of the inner gatehouse, 100 yards in length, and finally halt outside the doorway of the main watchtower. Great crowds of soldiers and civilians are running to and fro. Continue following the officer. If I feel like I stand a better chance of making my way to the King's Citadel, I don't need to follow this guy. I kind of feel like I can make it on my own. And I'm fully maxed out on health again. Yay. You fight your way through the press of bodies along the main street towards the citadel in the distance. City folk are rushing to and fro in the grip of panic as the cries of Kron are heard circling high above. In the crush, one item is stolen from your backpack. If you no longer have a backpack or if you have no backpack items, you lose a weapon. Remember to take this off your action chart. So one item stolen from my backpack, I'm gonna go ahead and lose a meal. A runaway horse and cart careen past and knock you into a doorway. You are stunned and you lose 2 endurance points. Well, that's rude. As you stagger to your feet, the door bursts open and a decrepit old man attacks you with a meat cleaver. He is quite insane and you must fight him or take evasive action. I'll fight him. He's quite insane. He's got a meat cleaver. He could be a threat to somebody. Gotta take him out. The wild old man is screaming at you. He blames you for the war and curses the Kai Lords as agents of the Dark Lords. He will not listen to reason and you must fight him. There's crazy old man with a cleaver. Yeah, that guy looks like he's up to no good. The wild old man is screaming at you. He wants me off his lawn. Time to fight. Time to fight. He looks like he'll be easy to defeat. 24 and 10. I lost 3, he lost 7. I lost nothing, he died. Yes, that was easy enough. So this crazy old man with a cleaver runs out at me and I just kind of put him down. Have a nice day, madman. The madman lies dead at your feet. 2 soldiers soon appear at the doorway and immediately congratulate you. They tell you that he was an escaped lunatic whom they had been tracking for the last 2 days. One of the soldiers gives you 10 gold crowns reward money and offers to escort you to the citadel. Cool. Now I have 40. Man, I'm coming up on the maximum there. That's amazing. Escort you? I would prefer to trust my own sense of direction. Thank you. For what seems like an eternity, the rush of the crowd carries you along like a leaf on a fast-flowing stream. You desperately fight to stay on your feet, but you feel weak and dizzy from your ordeal, and your legs are as heavy as lead. Suddenly, you catch the glimpse of a long, narrow stone stairway that leads up to the roof of an inn. Gathering the last reserves of your strength, you dive for the stairs and climb slowly up to the top. From here, you can see the magnificent view of the rooftops and spires of Holmgard, with the high stone walls of the citadel gleaming in the sun. Here's my rooftop view. Looks nice. The houses and buildings of the capital are built very close to each other, and it is possible to jump from one roof to the next. In fact, many of the citizens of Holmgard used to use the roofways, as they are known, when the heavy autumn rains made the unpaved parts of the streets too muddy for walking. But after many accidents, a royal decree forbade their use. After careful thought, you decide to use the roofways, as they are your only chance of reaching the king. You have hopped, skipped, and jumped across several streets, and you are only one street away from the citadel when you come to the end of a row of rooftops. The jump to the next row is much further than anything you have tried before, and your stomach begins to feel as if it were full of butterflies. Determined to reach the citadel, you turn and take a long run-up to the jump. With blood pounding in your ears, you sprint to the edge of the roof and leap into space, your eyes fixed on the opposite rooftop. Random number time to see if I fuck up. I got a 3. I'm glad I didn't get a 0 to 2, because that seems like the bad result. You land with such a crash on the opposite roof that the wind is knocked out of you, and you lie flat on your back with your head in a spin. It takes a minute or so for you to realize that you've made it and are perfectly safe. When you are sure you are all right, you jump up and let out a shout for joy at your skill and daring. Quickly, you find a way across the roof and climb down a long drain pipe to the street below. You see the large iron doors of the citadel open, and a wagon drawn by 2 large horses tries to leave. The horses are frightened by the noisy crowd, and they both rear up, causing the wagon to smash a front wheel against the door. In the confusion, you see a chance to enter and quickly slip inside just as the guards slam the doors shut. 24. The inner courtyard is a bustle of activity. Cavalry scouts are waiting beside their nervous horses for messages from their unit commanders inside the great hall. They take orders with great speed to the defenders of the outer field works. No sooner do they gallop off than other scouts return, many of them breathless and wounded. You have taken less than a dozen steps across the courtyard when you hear a deep voice boom out, "Stop that man!" Startled, you turn around to see a burly sergeant and 2 soldiers running towards you, their swords drawn as if to strike. You prepare to defend yourself, for it looks as if they were about to attack first and ask questions later. But suddenly the sergeant calls his men to a halt. He has recognized your cloak. They put away their weapons and apologize many times for their mistake. The sergeant orders one of the men to fetch the captain of the guard as he leads you to the doors of the great hall. You are greeted by a tall and handsome warrior who listens intently to your story. When you have finished the account of your perilous journey to the capital, you notice a tear in the brave man's eye as he bids you to follow him. You walk through the splendid halls and corridors of the inner palace. The richness and grandeur are a wonder to behold. You eventually arrive at a large carved door guarded by 2 soldiers wearing silver armor. You are about to meet the king. And I think we just won. Victory! You enter the Chamber of State, a magnificent hall decorated lavishly in white and gold. The king and his closest advisors are studying a large map spread upon a marble plinth in the center of the chamber. Their faces are lined with worry and concentration. A silence fills the hall as you tell of the death of your kinsmen and of your perilous journey to the citadel. As you finish your story, the king approaches and takes your right hand in his. There's the faces of the king and his closest advisors, lined with worry and concentration. There's the king with his crown, there's his advisors. There's the big hall with all the banners. Pretty cool. I like the style of Gary Chalk's illustrations. I always remembered these.
Lone Wolf, you have selfless courage, the quality of a true Kai Lord. Your journey here has been one of great peril, and although your news comes as a grievous blow, the spirit of your determination is like a beacon of hope to us all in this dark hour. You have brought great honor to the memory of your masters, and for that, we praise you.
He received the praise and heartfelt thanks of the entire hall, an honor that brings a certain redness to your young face. The king raises his hand, and all the voices cease.
You have done all that Summerland could have asked of a loyal son, but she is greatly in need of you still. The Dark Lords are powerful once more, and their ambition knows no bounds. Our only hope lies within Durinor, with the power that once defeated the Dark Lords an age ago. Lone Wolf, you are the last of the Kai. You have the skills. Will you journey to Durinor and return with the Summer Sword, the Sword of the Sun? Only with that gift of the gods may we crush this evil and save our land.
If you wish to accept the quest of the Summer Sword, begin your adventure with Book 2 of the Lone Wolf Adventures, Fire on the Water. And that's it. That we made it to the end of Book 1. Made it to the end of Flight from the Dark. This was it. Cool. We did it. What? How many times did I die? Just once? And that one bad decision, I died and I had to I didn't actually die in combat. And I don't think I made any other bad decisions. And I don't think I rolled low on any of the... on the, you know, like, make it roll a random number to not die ones. So yeah, we made it. Flight from the Dark. So, the next time, I will come back and I will do Book 2. So thank you for watching. This has been Josiah Plays Lone Wolf, Flight from the Dark.